I am Brad Keelor. He is Steve Kramer. Next up on our second holiday director's cut of 2022, you will hear him tell you why it was absolutely terrifying to write his geotechnical earthquake engineering book.
Well, it's Christmas time again. Decorations are all hung by the fire. Everybody's singing.
Hello again, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I'm the director of the Geo-Institute, and that is why we call this show Director's Cut. Every single week, I sit down with a different GI member. They tell us stories about their lives. Some of them are personal, some are professional, and every single one of them, every single week, somehow, they are all fun. If you don't know anything about the Geo-Institute, after you watch this amazing interview today, you should head over to geoinstitute.org. While you are there, you will find some really incredible stuff, like that we are a technical society with about 12,000 members, most of whom are geotechnical engineers and or geologists, and that we are part of the American Society of Civil Engineers. If you like what you see today, and I can pretty much guarantee that you're going to, you should click like, subscribe, get notifications. And if you do those things in that order, we will let you know every time we post something to the YouTube channel. As you can tell by my hat, my festive mood, it is still the holiday season, and this is our final episode of Director's Cut for calendar year 2022. We had to bring in the big guns for that. And so coming to you all the way from Seattle, Washington, is geo legend and professor emeritus from the University of Washington, Steve Kramer. Steve, welcome.
Thanks, Brad.
We're going to have an amazing time today. We have 10 questions for you, the same way that we have for everybody every week. And two of them are the same. And so we start with one of those. Describe your job in 45 seconds.
Well, I'm tempted to stare at you for 43 seconds and then say I'm retired. But my retirement has been an active one in that I'm still involved with research with the NGL Next Generation Liquefaction Project. I am working on the second edition of my book, which is getting very close to being completed. We're making example problems and homework problems now, and doing some consulting. And over the last little bit of time, I'm also a mover because my wife and I just moved into a downsized house that we remodeled. And so we're trying to unpack and get that sort of thing done. So it's keeping me plenty busy.
That's why you didn't go with the Santa hat today. It's still in a box somewhere, right?
Yeah, it's in a box that doesn't exist.
It would have been pretty good if you had just stared at me for 43 seconds. I would have been, nobody's ever done that before. We live for firsts on Director's Cut.
Who would laugh first?
We have to ask the fun questions on Director's Cut too. And I, you know, maybe fun is an overstatement on this one, unless you're going to hit us with something really good here. What time on average do you go to bed every night?
Probably like 11:30 or so. On average, we watch the 11 o'clock news and then go to bed. I get up on the early side, or usually around 5 o'clock, 5:30 or so, but I got in the habit of doing that early when my first daughter was born, and I've continued that.
Do you regularly sleep in on weekends or anything like that, or are you very regimented and you're up every day?
Well, I wouldn't say regimented. I just can't sleep in anymore, and I haven't been able to for a long time. So I just get up. Once I wake up, I'm awake, and I my mind starts going. I think about research or something, and I just get up and start working.
And I have to ask this too. Maybe it's because I live in Eastern time, but anytime I'm on Pacific time and I'm up past about 10 o'clock, it feels a little strange because I feel like there are a lot of people sleeping already. And it's weird that I'm still awake. I'm going to guess that is a phenomenon that doesn't affect you because you've lived so much of your life in that time zone.
Yeah, really, almost all of my time in the U.S. has been on the West Coast, except for 3 months in Chicago. It doesn't affect me very much. People are surprised sometimes when I on the East Coast when I call them at 8 a.m. their time, but you know, it works out okay.
Yeah, you don't need to do. This is the work habits I espouse anyway. And believe for all you GI members watching this, I do put in my time. So, but you don't need to have meetings before 10 or after 4. Those are rules I try to live by. We always ask a research question on Director's Cut. And yours is just going to be broad. We've done a couple of these recently. I figure with your breadth of experience, I'm just going to let you run with it. In your storied career, what research experience have you enjoyed the most?
I think when I look back at the work that I did with PEER, the Pacific Earthquake Engineering Research Center, that was established back in the mid-90s or so, and I was involved with the research committee and then the executive research committee and executive management committee, and I kind of had a lot of say in the direction of the geotechnical research. And what I really enjoyed was we would go down and have all the geotechs that were involved. It was universities in California and Washington, all very active in earthquake engineering research. And so we'd have meetings at Berkeley. And a lot of it was talking about liquefaction, a big, big part of my career and an important problem in geotechnical earthquake engineering. And so we would get, you know, Ross Belange, John Bray, John Stewart, Ahmed Algamo, Bruce Cutter, all people who really know are on the cutting edge of liquefaction. And we could all speak kind of the same language and understand the questions. And when you get into the weeds and the details, you'd find that there's not that many people you can really talk to. But we all get together with grad students and go over a lot of things and really did some important, what I think are some important work. It led to the work that I've done, the probabilistic liquefaction hazard analysis, and which has been a big part of my efforts over the last 15 years or so ago, and really to some degree continues with this next generation liquefaction project that I'm involved with now, working with John Stewart and Scott Brandenburg and other people. That's really, really interesting to with some of the tools that are available now, with the database that's being developed and machine learning and that sort of thing. And really, really bright people, young people that have these tools at their disposal. I'm kind of an advisor more than anything else, but it's a lot of fun working with them. And I think some really important stuff's going to come out of that also.
So I think one of the best things that is a consequence of these centers and this, you know, cross-pollination, even if it's people that are within the same discipline, is unexpected stuff happens, whether it's you meet somebody that you didn't know or you end up on a research path that you didn't think about before. What's the most unexpected thing that happened to you that was related to PEER?
I think just the breadth of people and disciplines that I got involved with, and it just expanded my understanding of the big problem of earthquake engineering and earthquake resistant design policy, because PEER had seismologists involved, structural engineers, geotechnical engineers, and policy and planning people, and just to get a better idea of the breadth of things that were involved in you know, public policy and you know, political aspects of policy, and seeing better where the geotechnical part that I had, you know, just been drilling into all of my career, to see how that fit in a bigger picture, and to get an appreciation for the interactions between these different disciplines and the way where geotech fit in that I didn't have before.
That's great. We're going to stick a little bit. We're going to put the fun questions aside for a minute. Well, no, this is a fun question. This is a crossover question. For all of our viewers, Steve retired a couple of years ago from UW. on the official page that announces your retirement on the University of Washington site, down at the bottom, it's a little snippet of a story about you getting another offer from another institution and using that as leverage to get new space, new lab space, new facilities at University of Washington. Can you walk us through that story?
Well, it, you know, when I came to UW, it was a very small geotechnical program. It was myself and one other faculty who was an associate professor at the time. My first class had three students in it. There were three practicing geotechnical engineers in the Puget Sound region with graduate degrees from University of Washington. And, you know, part of my job, my mandate was to try to help build the program up. And so we had a small program, and we're small for a long, long time with just three faculty after Bob Holtz joined us and then Pedro Arduino joined us. So we were kind of neglected within the civil engineering department, and it was frustrating. The three faculty were in one building, our students were in another building, and so it was very difficult to communicate the way we would have liked to. So that was frustrating. And with all this frustration, I decided when I got a recruitment pitch from another university, I decided to listen to it. And that recruitment pitch turned into a very attractive offer. And so I was very seriously tempted by it and considering it. During that time, there was an office next to mine that was empty. And I put a student that I was working with in there, and she and I talked all the time. We could work closely together, and I really, really enjoyed that relationship, which we'd kind of gotten away from just because of the physical distance between us. And so I got an offer from this other university. It was a very attractive offer. The UW put a retention package together, and they did what they could in terms of boosting salary. It was that was one factor, and they gave me a significant boost. But it wasn't, really that competitive with what I had been offered. So I asked them to remodel space for the geotechnical group and make kind of a geotechnical suite, combine some offices and that sort of thing. You very rarely have leverage at a university position. And I recognized that I did and probably never would again. And so I used it to hopefully benefit the program. And so they could reach into a different pot of money then for remodeling, and they did that. They came up short by about $80,000, something like that. And they put a pitch out to the local geotechnical firms, and they got all the donations in 2 days. And that really meant a lot to me, that support. So our small program that only had put out three people working in the area, there's several hundred people now. So the program's grown, and we've had this suite of offices that has been very effective. We can spend time with the students, and it's a nice space for them to get together and develop the kind of interactions you develop and friendships you develop as graduate students, and for us to interact with them in a way that we really couldn't before. So I think it worked out for me, and it worked out for the group, and it worked out for my family to stay in Seattle.
What a great story. And I mean, it's pretty inspirational too, because you think about all the grad students that were helped out by that, and what they've become now in their careers, because this was relatively long time ago, right, that this happened? Or
yeah, this was back in early 2003, 2004, something like that.
And I used to think when somebody said 2003, 2004, that was just a few years ago. It's now no longer a few years ago.
Yeah, that's right.
So a little inside director's cut here. When I write the questions for these interviews and I choose the guest, usually there's one question that's the centerpiece of the interview that I start with, and then I put everything else around that. And when I asked you if you wanted to be on, Steve, the one that was in my head was going to be about college basketball. There are these apocryphal stories of you playing college basketball, and I had never had it verified or denied because I'd never asked you directly about it. Did you play college basketball? And do you have any great stories about that?
Yeah, I did. I played at Cal Berkeley as a walk-on as a freshman. It was a lot of fun. It was something very different. I tried out for my high school basketball team and got cut twice, and pretty disappointing to me at the time. I didn't feel like it was fair, but I was. And so I played a lot still, just out on playgrounds and that sort of thing. And so when I got to Berkeley as a 17-year-old skinny freshman, I thought, well, I'll go for the hat trick and see if I can get cut a third time when they had open tryouts. And somehow I played well and made the team. And so it was a lot of fun. You know, it was great for me personally. Just I love playing basketball. It was good for my self-confidence. And so I played my freshman year. I may be one of the first one and dones that ever happened, but it was not for going to the NBA.
You took your talents to geotechnical engineering.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. It was, you know, it affected my grades. You know, it's a real time commitment. And so I could see the handwriting on the wall. It wasn't where my career was going to be. And so I bailed out on it after the first year and played intramurals, won a couple of intramural championships at least. But I played for years afterwards on various teams. And I would still be playing if my back allowed me to.
So I have to ask you a little bit about that one year, though. I mean, how much interaction at the time was there between the JV and the varsity teams and the coaches? I mean, Cal had a pretty legendary coach at the time, I believe. Did you have any interaction?
Yeah, we did. We would, you know, scrimmage together at times. And, you know, this was when it used to be, for many listeners, freshmen weren't eligible to play on varsity. And so that had just changed at the time that I was playing. So all the scholarship guys were basically on the JV team. And so we would scrimmage with the varsity and have interactions with them. You know, their varsity coaches would yell at us and just like the others. So it was fun that way. One of my good memories was the year that I played. UCLA was the dominant team, as it was through most of the 60s and 70s. And we could hang out after we finished practicing and watch UCLA practice. So, you know, John Wooden was the coach, and Bill Walton, Jamal Wilkes, Marcus Johnson were on the team. They had like seven or eight guys that played in the NBA. And so that was fun. It was fun to listen to John Wooden coach. He had he had this very grandfatherly image, and he had a voice like a foghorn. I mean, when he yelled, the rafters shook. So that was kind of shocking to us, but it was fun to have that opportunity. And we get in pickup games. Guys from the Warriors would come over, so you get in pickup games with the Warriors, and so that was a lot of fun also.
So this isn't really a natural follow-up question to this, but I think for people who played sports for many years, you have a greater tendency to, I think, second guess yourself. You look back on things that happened in games or in practice and you think, well, if I had done this, it might have gone differently. Do you feel like you've done that with your engineering career as well, or are you pretty easygoing about it and just keep moving forward?
Well, you know, you always look back and think of things you could have done differently or opportunities that you missed. I tend not to look back with that too much and just kind of figure out what's next, what's the next direction. I think of a lot of things that I didn't finish up the way I wish I had, papers I had didn't write or maybe probably still should try to write, but I tend not to beat myself up too much. I've worked hard. I know I've worked hard and I've done the best I could and kind of let the chips fall where they may.
I think by most accounts, if you asked 100 people on the street at Geo-Congress, they're probably going to say that you did okay.
Yeah, hopefully.
The other question that we ask everybody when they come on the show is, how did you first get involved with ASCE and GI?
Well, probably like most people, through the student chapter as an undergrad. And they had one in Berkeley and had monthly meetings. And so I attended those. I think I was an officer. I think I might have been like the secretary 1 year. And, you know, that led me to starting to become involved with ASCE. And I've been a member ever since then.
That was one of the quickest and most direct ASCE and GI stories we've had. And I mean, we're happy that you're still involved to this day. I think we always look for those volunteers who are going to be with us for the long haul rather than somebody who just kind of pops in once and is done.
Well, yeah, I've enjoyed it. I've had a number of roles on various committees and, you know, with the journal reviews and that sort of thing. And I think I'm just about to rotate off the GI Awards Committee now. And I've finished up with the TCC recently. So I think I'm at least for the moment about to be undirectly involved, at least.
We should have built a pitch in here for awards, too. So we're going to do that now for our viewers. If you don't know anything about the GI's awards program and the ASCE awards program, that's one thing you should do when you head over to geoinstitute.org is click that awards link, check out all the different categories. I think one of the most rewarding things is seeing colleagues honored for their work. Whether it's a paper award, whether it's a more lifetime achievement kind of thing, or whether it's a specific prize for one of our awards. Definitely think about nominating one of your colleagues. And our awards committee, full of, for now, Steve and people like him, will review those. And it's one of the most amazing things we do every year. And I always look forward to the awards ceremonies we do at Geo-Congress every year. So you should check that out.
Yeah.
Now, that segues nicely into an award that you received a few years ago. You were the SEED lecturer in 2018. And I don't think that was the first time that we had interacted, but it's very memorable to me for one major reason. When you sent your slide deck in, it had 149 slides. And I very nicely, very politely said, "This is only a 50-minute lecture." And you said, "That's okay. I'm going to get through all of them. Don't worry about it." And you did it. And so I have to ask you, what's the greatest number of slides you've ever presented as one talk?
Well, I think that might be about it. But I, a lot of times I'll have a smaller number of slides, but I'll have a bunch of clicks on each slide where I bring things up sequentially. And that's always been kind of my way of presenting things, rather than necessarily putting up a whole bullet list of items. I find that when people do that, I'm reading the list instead of listening to what they're saying at a particular point in time. And so I bring them up one at a time. It's kind of mind control of the audience, I guess. But I think it's effective for me in kind of sequentially guiding the audience through the points that I'm trying to make. And I, for important talks like the SEED lecture, and really for all my talks, I practice them. I practiced it quite a bit and made sure that I knew the timing of everything. So, you know, if you've got 500 people given an hour to listen to you, I feel an obligation to make it worth their while. And so, you know, I know what's coming next and I can be speaking without pausing to read the next slide that comes up, because I know what's coming up next. And so I've always tried to make an effort to make those presentations as clear as I can, and to use multiple clicks if I need to try to make my points.
Do you have any, I don't know, I was going to say weird habits, but if you do them routinely, it's probably not weird to you. Do you have any different habits that you employ when you practice big presentations like that? Or is it pretty straightforward and you just go through it over and over?
I go through it, and I make myself say the words out loud. So I get in my office at home or something, and it's easy to look at the slide and say, okay, I'm going to say this, I'm going to say this, I'm going to say this. But you gotta, to me at least, maybe other people it's easier for, but for me, I need to say the words out loud to really get my spiel down right and to be able to have a sense of the timing, because I knew in that talk you said 50 minutes and I knew 50 minutes was the goal, so I practiced it until I got it down to 50 minutes. All right, and my practice is probably 55 to 60, but I always go fast. I found that I always go faster when I'm actually doing it, and I always do it better than I practice it. So somehow I guess the pressure sharpens my focus, and I do it better that way.
You were impressive that day, because some people do treat that 50 minutes as a suggestion, and you knocked it out. I was shocked, but in a positive way. I usually don't repeat questions on Director's Cut, but I do have to ask this one, and I've asked this to a bunch of our award lecturers. So what was it like to get that call? Or I guess maybe in your case, it might have been a letter. I'm not sure how you found out about it initially. When you found out that you were going to be the Seed Lecturer in 2018, what went through your head?
Well, I guess, you know, Harry Seed was my advisor, my PhD advisor. And so my first thought was it was a great honor. My second thought was Harry Seed is probably turning over in his grave and thinking, Kramer? but it was just a great honor, you know, a great recognition for the work that I had put in. And I felt an obligation to do it as well as I could. And looking at the list of previous Seed lecturers, at least the ones in the Seed lecture every other year is for earthquake engineering, and the other years it's for general geotechnical engineering. When I look back at the list of the earthquake people, they were all people that I really admired and had looked up to over the course of my career. So it was pretty cool and unbelievable to me and to a degree to see my name added to that list.
And for those watching who haven't seen Steve's lecture, we'll put a link to it in the show notes in the field below where you're watching this right now. Now, I had to ask this next question too, because to me, you're one of the funniest people in the geotech world. I don't know that there's a lot of competition. And Ken Stokey, if you're watching this right now, I said one of the funniest. So he's probably not losing his crown there. But you are sort of the Andy Richter, to use a Conan analogy here. You're like the straight man. You're very witty. You have great comebacks. So I had to ask you, the flip of that, what's your favorite joke that you've ever told?
Well, I'm not much of a joke teller. I can never remember them. I hear jokes, I laugh at them, but in general, I can't remember them. Excuse me. So I'm better at making kind of off-the-cuff wisecracks than I am at telling jokes. But I'll try one. It's a joke my wife tells, and it's clean enough to say, and I'm really wishing now that I'd written it down. But it's about the god of thunder, Thor. And so, oh man, I'm going to mess this up. Thor comes down from the heavens and meets this virgin, and the virgin has a lisp. And Thor says, I'm going to, he comes down and it's this beautiful virgin, but she has a lisp. And Thor makes romance with her, makes love to her. And it's a beautiful thing for Thor, I guess. And so the next day, he comes to her and he thinks to himself, this isn't fair. She's going to think everyone is like me, and I'm the god of thunder. And so he said, I need to go tell her. And so he says, he comes down to her and says, listen, I need to tell you something. You know, I am, it's not always going to be like this. I'm the god of thunder. I'm Thor. And she says, you're Thor. I can hardly pith. So cue the laughter.
Pretty solid delivery.
Well, I don't know about that, but my wife tells it better than I do.
I think that might be only the second or third joke we've had on all of our episodes of Director's Cut. So you've joined a very esteemed group up there at the top.
Well, I apologize to everyone with a lisp. You have to offend somebody to tell a joke, I guess.
We have two questions left, and the next one is the one that we teased at the top of the show. Your geotechnical earthquake engineering, it was the first book ever on that topic. And when I was thinking about this, I wondered, was it easy or hard to write the first book on that topic? I can imagine it would be, you know, somewhat exciting, but also kind of terrifying at the same time.
Yeah, it was challenging and difficult in a lot of respects. You know, as you said, there wasn't an existing book. When I took this material from Harry Seed, when I took the earthquake engineering class, he gave us a stack of his papers to read. And, you know, it was about 4 inches thick or so, and I read them. They were great, great papers, but they're technical papers. They weren't textbooks. You know, it was not as explanatory as a textbook would be. And so I was, you know, teaching this material and using handouts and papers and that sort of thing, like everybody else did. And I thought, man, it would really be nice to have a book on this subject. And I kind of looked around and thought, well, this is something I could do that would, you know, allow me to make a contribution to the profession, you know, if I did it right, and help make a name for myself, and it would be an interesting thing to do. I could learn a lot by doing it. So I went ahead and started it. I was 36 years old when I started it. It was difficult in that, you know, if I was going to write another basic soil mechanics book or introduction to geotechnical engineering, there were like 10 that I could have put out on a table and said, well, I like this from this one and I like that from that one. But there was nothing, there was no model to go by. So I had to spend a lot of time deciding what was going to be in, what was going to be out, what the scope was going to be. And some of the subject matter I felt like I knew really well, but other aspects of it, like the hazard analysis, probabilistic hazard analysis, I knew the math, but I didn't really, it wasn't my main area. And you're always concerned that you're missing some of the nuances or the subtleties of a particular subject. So, I did the best I could, but I was always a little bit nervous about some of the subjects and how they would be received by people who knew it well, knew those subjects well. I also knew all along that Bob Whitman and Ricardo Dobry had been working on a soil dynamics book, and I had never seen it. I've still never seen the manuscript, but they had parts of it that they were using in their classes. And so I was worried that if they got wind of the fact that some guy in Seattle that they'd never heard of was doing something like this, it would have motivated them to finish their book. And then you'd have, you know, Whitman and Dobry on the shelf and some guy named Kramer on the shelf, and who's going to pick Kramer's book? So I wrote like 90% of it before I even contacted a publisher, because I was just trying to keep it quiet. I think Bob Holz was about the only, and my immediate colleagues were the only ones who knew that I was working on it. And so I spent about 4 years writing it, about 6,000 hours is my estimate of the time that I spent on it. And, so I got it done and it came out and the feedback has been pretty good on it. And it's worked out well. The PSHA, the probabilistic seismic hazard analysis stuff, it was kind of interesting because about a month or so after it came out, I got a letter back when people wrote letters on paper, and it came in my mailbox from Stanford University, and it said in a corner, C.A. Cornell, Alan Cornell, who's the guy who invented probabilistic seismic hazard analysis. And it was a thick letter. And I thought, oh, geez, this is... Alan, and so I opened it up, you know, with my hands shaking practically, and he had taken the time to write the nicest letter to me. I always kept it in the top right drawer of my desk, praising the manner in which I had explained this stuff, and said it's even got disaggregation, which was kind of a new topic or a new concept at that time. And you know, what the thickness came from, he sent me some stuff that he was working on and suggesting maybe we can work together on some of this stuff. So it was really a kind, thoughtful, generous thing that he did to take the time to do that. And later I got to know him pretty well. We worked on consulting projects together. He was just a fascinating guy, one of the people I really have looked up to over my career.
Like, that wasn't that terrifying at all. That's actually a pretty heartwarming story for everybody out there. So, you know, maybe if they're thinking about writing a book, that's more inspirational than it was discouraging.
I really enjoyed it. When I had time to work on it, and it takes blocks of time to do it, but yeah. I had to think a lot about what I was going to put in. And there, over the course, like in any discipline, there are competing theories and approaches to various problems. So I had to kind of balance all of that stuff out, because I was a nobody at that time. And, you know, I referenced the hell out of everything. I put in everybody's references as much as I could. So nobody was, you know, there were people could look, investigate different approaches and that sort of thing. But it worked out well. You know, I think it had a broader impact than on the profession than a bunch of papers that I could have spent that time writing would have. And it certainly, you know, I get contacts from people around the world about it. And when I go places, you know, people appreciate it, and it's been helpful to them to understand these concepts better.
That is fantastic. A great story there. We're down to our last question, and I feel bad because you got a couple of vague questions today. Your research question was kind of vague, but you performed admirably. I suspect you will do the same on this one. We are in the thick of the holiday season as we record this, and probably viewers as you watch this. Steve, we have to ask, what is your favorite of all time holiday memory?
Yeah, that's a vague question. I'll give you a pretty vague answer, I think, because I don't have any single specific memory. It's more, I remember the excitement I had when I was a little kid around Christmas and opening the presents. And then I remember the excitement that my own kids had when they were small and they were opening the presents and the whole Christmas season. Maybe if I had to pick one, you know, my wife and I grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area, and, you know, it never snows there. And we moved up to Seattle, and we'd been here for, maybe 5 or 6, 7 years or so. And my kids were great in that they slept in when they were kids. They were really good sleepers. You know, we never had the kids getting up at waking up at 5 in the morning and screaming for attention. It was they would sleep in, and my wife would sleep in back in those days. And so I got up early one morning, and I come downstairs, and it was snowing, and it snowed a lot overnight. It was kind of unexpected, and so it was a white Christmas. A white Christmas was something that we had just kind of read about, or you'd see it in some stupid Hallmark movie or something. And I had a hard time waking them up to come downstairs and open their presents and look out and see the snow falling. But it was kind of a magical time for us, the first white Christmas we'd ever experienced.
And I think people don't realize that, because, you know, I lived in Michigan until I was in high school, and there was snow on the ground all the time, winter. When we moved to Virginia, you know, every year in the weather forecast, will it be a white Christmas? Well, The answer is always no, for anybody wondering out there. I think there have been three in recorded history in Washington, D.C. And so it is a huge deal. Were they excited when they eventually got down and saw the snow?
Oh, yeah. It was fun. They opened up their presents and pretty quickly, and we just went outside and built a snowman, played in the snow. So it was a lot of fun.
That is great. Well, Steve, you survived. You made it through all 10 questions, and you did a great job, and everybody got to know you a little bit better, and you told a joke, told an excellent joke. I mean, this director's cut really had something for everybody, I feel like. So for our viewers, if you liked what you saw and you're here at the end, so you probably did, click like, subscribe, get notifications. We will, of course, let you know every single time we post something to the channel. You know how I always say that we record director's cut every week, except during the summer and 1 week at the holidays? Well, that's next week. We will be back in 2 weeks with our best of 2022 episode, and then back the week following that with brand new Director's Cut episodes. So for all our viewers, you survived all 47 episodes all year. You deserve a gold star as well. Spend your holidays watching some of those classic Director's Cut episodes. So Steve, thanks you so much for doing this and making it fun for everybody.
You're welcome. Happy holidays, everybody.
And to all of our viewers, we will see you in 2 weeks with our best of 2022.
Now let's see. I want a new Rickenbacker guitar. Two Fender bassmans.
Go for it.
Well, after I graduated, I continued playing basketball, and I played on kind of a semi-pro team, and we'd go around and play basically anybody who would play us. So we played military base teams. We'd also go into prisons and play prison teams, and that would be kind of interesting because you'd go in and sign hostage release waivers. Saying that, you know, they're not going to come in and get you if things go bad. And, so we played in one in Vacaville State Prison, which was like the mental hospital prison in California, and walked right past Charles Manson's cell. He actually had a cell inside a cell. But, that was an interesting experience. And then I'll tell you another one.
So you're saying no hard fouls in those games?
You know, they were remarkably not rough. You know, we went in thinking, okay, we better, you know, if they hit us, we got to hit them back, or else, you know, we're gonna be punked for the rest of the game. But it was really surprisingly non-physical, and I think it was because if they played that way, they'd have fights.
Oh, well, that's
stabbings
true.
And all that sort of
and
thing.
And probably but, not you know. Be allowed to play basketball anymore, which
yeah. But I was guarding a guy and started talking to him, you know, during the game. And, I'm like this kid from the suburbs, you know, and I'm saying, yo, man, what are you in for? this guy turned out he was the original lead singer of Tower of Power, which was a band that I really liked a lot and still do. And he got involved with drugs and ended up
wow.
killing somebody in a drug deal gone bad. But that was kind of interesting. So yeah, I don't know if you're a Tower Power fan or know much of their work, but Rick Stevens,
that's a pretty wild story though.
Yeah, Rick Stevens was his name. And so some of their early stuff, You're Still a Young Man, that song, he's the lead singer on that.
Wow.